time, and here is Brian Rees, and give all the praise, the honour and the glory to the Lord Jesus Christ himself, God the Son. And today, I'm going to start with a request from the Democratic Republic of Congo, right here in Central Africa. And it is a most wonderful request because it has brought us into contact with the Anglican Diocese of Katanga and have been able to share on a number of occasions now through email with the diocesan bishop, the Right Reverend Bertin Mwale Subi. And it is here that the requests are, do pray for the Archdeaconry of Manono. Manono is a big area where the church is grown very fast. There are about 15 churches. It says, pray for peace. Well, Heavenly Father, as I'm working through this, this prayer request is quite a lengthy one, so I speak to you as I'm going along, because you're such a wonderful God, a prayer-hearing and a prayer-answering God. And we're told by Bishop Bertin that about these 15 churches and saying, pray for peace. Now, who is peace? Well, is your beloved Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He is our peace. And may his peace come and rest within each of these churches and the whole body of Christ in the Archdeaconry of Manono. And not just that, but the whole of the Diocese of Katanga and the whole of the Democratic Republic of Congo. Among Bantus and Pygmies. Oh, we've got two people groups here, Father. It says the conflict started 2 years ago. And where does conflict come from? It comes from the heart which has not yielded itself unto the Lord Jesus Christ, has not relinquished its sin. And these people groups, well, how can they have seen, Father, thy beloved Son, when they're fighting each other? It's the very devil himself who causes this fighting. So, I looked at the one who is peace, will bring an end to this conflict. The revelation through the Holy Ghost of thy beloved Son on the cross of Calvary. Because one look at the crucified one. One look at Calvary, Father. And the conflict must stop. Because they've seen what you gave. Their very best, the one perfect sacrifice for sin forever. This situation puts the church in more difficulties. Ah, but there are always solutions with thee, Father. We need to pray that God send people in the church to go and teach about peace and conflict resolution, I should say. But unless it's the Prince of Peace who's being preached, then there'll be no resolution. The Anglican Church is giving hope to this community by giving food. Yes, the food of life, but also him who is life, who is food, who is, I am the bread of life. Oh, may the bread of life, oh Jesus Christ, reach right through the whole of the Democratic Republic of Congo. Then we have the further request, Father. Stabilities. DR Congo is facing conflict relative to an upcoming election. The political parties are in dialogue to find out how can prepare the upcoming election. Oh, go before, show the way. Show the way, O God, who has ordained those governments to rule, to govern in peace. May they have that peace in their hearts. There is a misunderstanding within politicians because of Joseph Kabila want to stay on power. Well, what are you going to do about that, Father? Is this Joseph Kabila one who knows thyself as the living God through the atoning blood of the Lord Jesus Christ? Should he not be? Either save his soul or remove him from office and bring in one who has a heart, the heart of God within them, the living God in Jesus Christ. Then pray for St. Paul Cathedral in Katanga, who are still looking for funds to furnish the cathedral, the symbol of the Anglican Church of Katanga. Well, above that, may the cathedral of St. Paul be filled with thy presence, O God, the presence of the living God. The Christian contributes with something, but this is not enough to finish the building. Well, may be seen that the building is the body of Christ, the living stones, those who have Christ dwelling within their hearts. Pray for the new Bishop of Katanga. Yes, here we are, Bishop Bertin, the one I'm in very much in touch with. Sent him a message yesterday. No, the day before. Yesterday it was. And the dear bishop, yes, who takes this important role as Bishop of Katanga Diocese. I know his predecessor. I couldn't get any response from him. Perhaps may not have understood, but this bishop certainly does. He has many challenges to face. May the Lord give him wisdom and intelligence to guide his people to salvation. Yes, that who is wisdom, O Father? It is thy beloved one too. It's all in the Lord Jesus Christ. Many thanks, Brian. Looking to hear from you, Bishop Bertin Subi. Now, how many Anglican diocesan bishops are writing to me with their prayer requests? The answer to that appears to be known. None. As far as the Church of England goes, the Church in Wales, the Episcopal Church of Scotland, and the Church in Ireland. No, they don't want to know. But these dear ones, like Bishop Bertin, and he's not the only one who was in touch. That it's so wonderful. Yes, Archbishop Foley Beach of the North American Anglicans sent to him the other day and had a most encouraging response. Others in Africa too. And then let's have a look what else it is. Oh, this is some more. Another part of the province of Katanga. Insects are infected the culture's products. Oh, right there. Well, Lord, oh Father, that, well, we can even bring the insects and ask for them to be dismissed, that they will not in any way cause a disruption here. The state service want to confiscate our church's ground, where we can build the schools and to make many activities. God push them to give up this idea. Can protect our ground, I bind now through the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, not only to push these idea, but I bind that they will not be able to do anything. They will not be able to take anything whatsoever which belongs to thyself, O God. And it says politics are a problem in DR Congo. Something about Senko meditation can have successful conclusion, desirable for peace in our country. Well, the peace is in the Prince of Peace. the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, may he be enthroned there on the hearts of politicians as well as those clergy and the body of Christ within DR Congo. And this is from the blessed Reverend Jean-Jacques Bukasa, and he's one of the two clergy which Bishop Bertin has said that he will have studying courses with us, selected courses which have been selected to by with the bishop, not that we've selected them for him. And that is amazing, that ones in the DR Congo are now to be students, distant students with us, to the glory of God. So I commit all this to thee, O Father, and by faith, it is done through the Lord Jesus Christ and for thy glory alone. Amen. We have rather a contrast now with the bishop from an old, well-known to me, John Francham, there in Pembrokeshire, in St. David's. And, I forgot to mention the scripture that I was praying on, so let's remember it. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. That's Acts chapter 12 and verse 5. Let's not forget the scripture for John Francham. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 5. Well, John is an evangelist, called mightily of God, enabled, empowered by God. And John says, please pray for me as I evangelize locally, that is in the St. David's area. I've composed three new hard-hitting tracts about Islam, the National Health Service, and the Blessed Holy Spirit as part of the unipural nature of God. The latter is aimed at destroying the false teachings of the Jehovah Witnesses. I've been receiving a good response from the public when I stand down the road from the JWs. The NHS leaflet depicts the astronomical costs in treating the diseases because of immorality. The Islamic leaflet bears the hard, cold facts about Islam. Please pray for our protection as a family. I value your prayers tremendously. Your fellow servant in Christ, John Francham. He must be going on his coach trip shortly, because when he goes on his coach trips to give out his literature in different parts of Wales and England, he comes and lets me know about them, and then gives a report. Father, thank thee for such as John Francham, this evangelist who stands fearlessly to make known the glorious gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, thy beloved Son. He's not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. And may that power of God unto salvation continue to be made known through John and all like him, all street preachers, and blow thy wind upon those who come against street preachers and smite them and reduce them to dust. Because they're not just coming against thee. Like John, they're not just coming against him and these other dear ones, but they're coming against my beloved one, the Lord Jesus Christ. And just as I hear these reports from abroad of ones being reduced to ashes because they've dared to come against the gospel. What about it in this country too? You're the same God. Father, your honour's at stake, whilst thy word is being, not just it being forbidden, thy word is being downtrod. You are God, act as God. Otherwise, how can I trust thee? And for John, as he makes known and gives out these leaflets to those in Islam, and about the National Health Service, and about the Jehovah's Witnesses, yes, the false teachings from the pit of hell itself, the Jehovah's Witnesses, because they deny the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. O God, show thyself, make bare thy holy arm in these days, and smite the enemy of souls wherever he dares to come and try to interfere. Because this is an absolute blockage. And this week has been very much one for remove blockages. And it will continue in the weeks ahead. And where the Jehovah Witnesses, and where anyone comes to dare to stand against the street preacher, I remove through the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ these blockages. I bind the strong man and release the conditions now for the preaching of the gospel. And anyone who dares to come against it, O God, show them that you are the Almighty God, and you will not be mocked at all. For it is done now through thine own authority of the words of the Lord Jesus, who said, if ye abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. For thy glory and for thy glory alone, O Father. Amen. I continue reading more of this report now from the Society for the Distribution of the Hebrew Scriptures. I started it last time. The report of distribution in North London. And it's always so encouraging to read how God's people, the Jews, the ancient people, the Jews, the Jews who through whom he brought us the wonderful scriptures, and through whom he brought us the Lord Jesus Christ himself, a Jew. After some hard responses, we persevered in a different road, where we met a Jewish man, about 60 years old. He opened the door, listened and said, I am shocked. He had tears in his eyes as he said there was so much hatred these days against the Jewish people. It was very good to hear that some people love them, and I love them too. And I looked at the Jehovah you bring me into contact with Jews that I can love, for the love of Christ to love them through me. He was very happy to receive the scriptures and said, I am flabbergasted. Bless your work. This is wonderful, a wonderful response in such a hard area. Please pray that the pleasure he had will convert into desire to read of his own Messiah, who alone can bring peace to a world so filled with hatred against them. Ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen. Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 10. Later in the same road, we rang a bell, and when no one answered, we moved on. A few minutes later, the previous door opened, and there stood an elderly Jewish lady walking with a walking stick. She obviously had had great difficulty getting to the door. So we hurried back and quickly told her about the scriptures, which she accepted immediately. Joy bent down and picked up the poor lady's post for her. She was so thankful for our visit and help and said, very sincere, thank you. As we departed, at the end of this street, we rang a bell and heard a voice saying, who is it? Then the door opened a little on a chain, and a middle-aged Jewish lady pecked her head round. She spoke with a Russian accent, and we handed her the scriptures through the slightly open door. Oh! She exclaimed with obvious pleasure, what shul, synagogue, do you go to? Praying for wisdom, we explained we were Christians, with a great love for the scriptures and the Jewish people, and told her why we wanted to give her this gift. She smiled most kindly and took a tanaka with a CD and said, thank you. Often as we go along the roads, we meet up with workmen, and we are always ready to give them scriptures in their own language, if possible. Just as we walked along, we saw a young Polish man working with four other young men on a house. He smiled but refused a Trinitarian Bible Society New Testament. Then one of his co-workers came up and said the Polish word for Bible. With that, the man said, okay, and leave, there. He put down five Trinitarian Bible Society New Testaments in the van for them. And he smiled and thanked us. The postman also accepted a testament. And after our explanation said, oh, go. On then, cheers. A young woman living in a house with a mezuzah, who was not Jewish, gladly received the testament. The previous owner had left the mezuzah on the doorpost. The Lord was blessing the testaments to non-Jews too, and we immediately gave another testament to a young Polish man, and then later to some British people. Later we were surprised when the door opened and a Jewish man stood there in a long grey garment, looking somewhat dishevelled. He listened, then said sadly, but I can't donate anything. When we told him that it was a free gift of love, he gave a broad smile and said, oh, thank you very much. Oh, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat. Yea, come, buy wine and milk without money, without price. Isaiah chapter 55 and the first verse. That morning, Roberta had prayed the Lord would give us a special encounter with one Jewish person. His prayer was answered when we met a couple that were so pleased to be given the scriptures. They asked us in. Accepting their kindness, we went in and they made us coffee. The man looked at me, Tanak, and said, "This is a beautifully produced book. How do you get the money to provide such handsome volumes to give away like this?" As we explained the work, this lovely couple were both deeply touched. He then looked carefully at the CD, and we talked about how sad it is that the media is biased against Israel. His wife was a lovely lady, but we could sense her insecurity and nervousness toward us. She told us that her husband had studied the New Testament. We found this very encouraging. I thought maybe we were the next link in the Lord's chain towards them finding him. "Seek ye the Lord whilst he may be found. Call upon him whilst he is near." Isaiah 55 and the 6th verse. The Lord enabled us to have a very broad conversation. Joyce spoke about how the secularists have undermined the Judeo-Christian ethos of previous days. He then said, "Yes, you are quite right. It is a disgrace. It's like the Tower of Babel in the Bible. Everyone is going against God." Then she asked us, "What kind of response have you had in this area?" We told them that we had had a very good response, and they both seemed very pleased. As we parted, the lady said to Joy, "You are very articulate, and you know a lot about the Jewish people. We need people like you to speak up for us." "Well," replied Joy, "there are a lot more like us, more than you think, and we pray for the Jewish people. We shall remember and pray for this couple, and before their days are ended, they will see and believe in the one who came as Israel's Messiah and the Savior of the world. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly." John chapter 10 and the 10th verse. He went on to the next door with a mezuzah and rang the doorbell. A tall, handsome young Jewish man opened the door. "That's very kind of you. Thank you," he said as he reached out and gladly received the scriptures. We did have some refusals because a lot of very orthodox people will not even speak to with us. However, the next response was from a house with a very friendly cat. As we bent down to stroke it, we saw the mezuzah and rang the bell. A very orthodox woman opened the door, her hair covered by a soft black hat. We chatted about her lovely cat and offered her a Tanaka and CD. "You don't want any money for it, and you're not coming again?" she asked, quizzically. We assured her they were a gift, and we were not coming back. She smiled, and to our delight took them. As we left, we turned and saw that she was cuddling her lovely cat and smiling in a most friendly way. She was very orthodox, and we thanked the Lord for her wonderful response, a real answer to prayer. At the next door, a middle-aged Jewish man answered with a lovely dog, whose name was Nike, standing beside him. The dog was gentle and friendly, which helped to break the ice. We offered the man the scriptures, which he immediately took with a smile, saying, "And I was just thinking nobody gives you anything for free." As he thanked us graciously, a friend arrived wearing a kippah. Sadly, we had nothing left to give the friend, but we were glad that we had given all the scriptures we had taken that day. So he pointed out the society's address and told him to contact the office, and anything he wanted would be sent freely to him. As he walked away from the door, the first man said, as he looked at the scriptures, "I shall have great pleasure in reading this." At the close of this blessed day, we prayed and praised the Lord that in such an orthodox area, the Lord had enabled us to give 12 Jewish people scriptures. We did have one Tanakh left, but it was slightly damaged, so we drove to the local independent Jewish school. They are not always accepted, but at the end of this day, the secretary gave us a lovely smile and thanked us, receiving the gift with much pleasure. Jehovah, the heart rejoices at this wonderful, wonderful report of these dear people accepting the scriptures, accepting the words of life, and may each one of them come to know their own Messiah, to receive him into their heart. And that many, many in these days shall come to know their own God, whom you sent to give his life as a ransom for all who will turn to him. Praise thee, O Father. Praise thee, Jehovah. For it is offered through thy beloved one, Yeshua, and for thy glory. Amen. And to read some more now from this wonderful, wonderful book, The Intercessions of Rees Howells, written by Doris M. Rusko, and published by the Lutterworth Press. And I'm so grateful for Miss Rusko, that lady who I saw many years ago when I was a student at the Bible College of Wales. What I'm going to do is just turn back and cover some of what I read last week, otherwise it's not going to make a great deal of sense. Perhaps, says Miss Rusko, Rees Howells reached the greatest heights of biblical exposition in dealing with the life of Moses, because Miss Rusko was one who would have been in these particular meetings. And she is speaking from her own experience of those times with Rees Howells. We were moved to our depths and taken into a realm hitherto unknown, as the Holy Spirit through Rees Howells showed us a man on his face before God for 40 days and nights, prepared even to sacrifice his eternity for the sake of his people. It was God's dealing with these men, their positions of faith, their walk as intercessors, that enabled Rees Howells to attain to the faith he needed himself in his own dealings with God. Over and over again, faith came in the actual meetings, while he was speaking, and as he went through, so did we along with him. In finance, he had to get the faith to buy property without money, something of which he had no experience before the purchase of Glyn Derwin, the first college property, and then Derwin Vower, where the college was firmly established. as he was led along the difficult path of liability to an ever deeper extent, and as he reached out in faith and intercession for the world vision, every meeting was vital to him. Only as the Holy Spirit gave light on the positions of faith as yet beyond him, which the men of the Bible had attained, was he able to accept the responsibility for the task given to him and to believe that God would take him through. We came to see that every meeting meant to him, and he needed our cooperation. It was necessary to concentrate on every word, to follow the line of thought, and to trust the Holy Spirit to give us, up to our more limited capacity, the light he was giving him, and so be able to believe with him when the assurance came. Without that, the whole point of a meeting could be lost, and it would be difficult to pick up the threads for the next meeting. This is why there was such a quality of life in the meetings, as we with him reached out for the faith required for each crisis. What it must have been to have been in those meetings. And I know I would too, when I was a student under Rees Howells' son, Samuel Rees Howells. There were some quite amazing meetings then. But these seem to be of another level, a higher level. And it is in these days too that we here at the college, which continues the vision of Rees Howells, that the Lord is taking us step by step, stage by stage, to a higher level. May we be able to reach that very level that Rees Howells reached. We can only do it not of ourselves, but only as the Holy Ghost lives in us and lives through us, as we relinquish all, just like Rees Howells relinquished all. He will do it, just as he did through Rees Howells. That is the confidence. He's speaking to me very clearly in these days, is the Holy Ghost. And he's impressing upon me, yes, what I mentioned earlier about blockage removals. And he's granting faith, his own faith, that the exceeding abundantly will be done. And that all that dares to come against the gospel reaching every creature, just as he did with Rees Howells, there were blockages. And through intercession, they were removed. And continuing, there were times when the Holy Spirit would break through with great light and give the assurance that the prayer was answered, or he would show us what God's purpose was. Then the whole was full of God's presence, and prayer turned to praise and worship. Times like these, there was such a release in the spirit. Rees Howells was never afraid to relax. For the time being, perhaps a day or two, he might cancel all the meetings and take two or three carloads of us up to the Black Mountain and descend upon his cousins in a Welsh village for a real Welsh tea. That's something lovely. Something wonderful. When a break in the spirit came, he would sometimes say that he shot out into space and the glory of God was on him. And we too tasted that joy of heaven which was to be experienced, to be realized. Nothing here of the rather, well, artificial, self-motivated of what calls itself Christianity and Church today. January 1937, brought never-to-be-forgotten days to the college, when the person of the Holy Spirit was revealed, a revelation which came to staff and students alike, and which produced an indescribable awe in the presence of ineffable holiness and majesty. Nothing there of the purple flashing lights. No, not at all. The presence of God. Oh, my. His holiness and his majesty reduced to silence. Day after day, we wear on our faces before him. And often night was as day, as his hand was upon us. Now we knew who was our real leader from the time forward, and we accepted his dealings, his discipline, his guidance, his commands, at whatever cost. Yes, totally surrendered to the Holy Ghost. The person of the Holy Ghost. There were times when he led us into deeper and deeper personal experiences of himself, into closer union and fellowship with the Lord Jesus. In his death and resurrection, the Psalm the Easter of 1939 was specially memorable. Director's messages were based on Romans 6, and for days the Holy Spirit rested on the college as one and another realized their identification with the Lord Jesus in his death and resurrection. As others joined our fellowship later, light was given on the words of the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 12, and the first verse. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. The Holy Spirit made very real to every individual what it meant to be on that altar. He was anointing us for the warfare in the heavenlies during the war years. And we were being drawn together into a closely knit community, dedicated to fight the Lord's battles, concerned before everything else for the kingdom of God. That doesn't sound like a description of what's called community churches these days. Far from it. A feature of the college for many years was the annual Every Creature Conference, held in August, to which leaders of missions, missionaries, and speakers from different parts of the world came. Many people have been blessed through the ministry of Rees Howells, and the meetings were always crowded to overflowing throughout the week. There was always much blessing during the conference, and many responded to the call for full surrender. Oh, where are those responding in these days, O God, to the call for full surrender? To the Lord, to the call for service. Not pray for me. No, far from it, just the opposite. Surrendered completely to God, for him to use you. Have you totally surrendered, fully surrendered to him? The conferences were discontinued during the war years and resumed afterwards. Rees Howells' last conference was in August 1949, and his messages were outstanding, with a conviction that the Holy Spirit would unite all believers in the great cause of world evangelization. And that is the cry now unto thee, Almighty God, that there will be the conviction on those believers who are not united in the great cause of world evangelization. Time seems to have flown by, so I'll leave JCO on prayer to another time and continue instead with the account, the Hebrides Revival and Awakening, 1949 to 1953, and acknowledging that this has been written by Alec Dunn and compiled from various sources that he has acknowledged at the front of his book. See where we left off. Here we are. When the people, on that particular night when the Holy Ghost came, revival came, God's presence filled Barbas and the people who've been at the meeting, the service in Barbas Kirk that particular night. And they'd left, but they hadn't got very far. They were outside the door. And then, yes, the Holy Ghost came down, and the doors were opened for them. And they came back in, but more and more people were coming, carrying what their stools or whatever they were going to sit on, because the place was packed out, so packed out that some were even in the steps of the leading up to the pulpit, and one dear young woman, a teacher, crying out for mercy, "Oh God, is there mercy for me? Oh God, is there mercy for me?" And we're told that the dear Peggy and Christine Smith, oh yes, their vision, the old lady's vision of a church crowded with young people, as well as old, had now become a reality. So I pick it up at that point. And this is Duncan Campbell speaking. "I gave out my text and started preaching. For the Spirit of God was moving in such a way that I had to stop preaching after a few minutes because my voice could not be heard as men and women were crying out for mercy all over the building. I just stood still and gazed upon the wondrous works of God." My, can we picture it? Service there, packed church, and the preacher had to stop, because the cries for mercy were so great, he couldn't be heard. "Oh, God, do it again!" That meeting continued until 4 o'clock in the morning. I couldn't tell you how many were saved that night, but of this I am sure, that at least 5 young men who were saved that night are ministers today in churches in Scotland. Wasn't that quite something? God at work. At 4 o'clock we decided to make for the manse. Of course you understand we had no appeals, apart from asking those who wanted to get right with God to come to a further meeting where we would quote the scripture to them. But basically, we just left men and women to make their way to God themselves. No need for anything else. God was in the midst. And he, the Holy Ghost, the third person of the God, of the Trinity, was bringing revelation upon the Word of God. Revelation that sin is sin. Revelation of the atoning blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Revelation to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. When God takes a situation in hand, I tell you, he does a better work than we could ever do. Yes, much today gets in the way of God doing his work. Much what calls itself Christianity, much which calls itself church, in fact is a blockage for God's work to be done. And these blockages need to be removed. So we left them there. And just as I was leaving the church, a young man came to me and said, Mr. Campbell, I would like you to go to the police station. Well, that seems rather an unusual request. But this was the night that God came down. For there must be at least 400 people gathered around there just now. Can you picture it? 400 people gathered around the police station. And what were they gathered around for? A crowd of men and women from a neighboring village 5 or 6 miles away. So it's not like they'd were living in the village. And no doubt many of them would have walked there. Probably most of them would have walked there. And remember that this is during the night. Had been so convicted by God. When God takes the field and he took the field there, that there is real conviction of sins. Not mocking, as goes on in these days. That they found themselves moving to the police station. Why? Because the constable was a God-fearing man and well-saved man. He wasn't a novice. And next to the police station was the cottage. Take note here, next to the police station was the cottage, and who lived in the cottage? The two old women. People knew that this was a home that feared God. I believe that had something to do with the magnet, the power that drew men. If anyone would ask them today, why? How did it happen? Who arranged it? They couldn't tell you. This is the moving of God's Spirit. Nothing generated through self. No, no, no. A believing answer to the prevailing prayer of men and women who believe that God was a covenant-keeping God, who must be true to his covenant engagement. Better leave it at that bit, because otherwise I'll be going over time. So, thank thee. Thank thee, O God Almighty. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost working together in perfect unity. And how you worked in perfect unity that night when you came down in Barbas. And may at this particular time now, the conditions be brought into being. Where hands, the cry is, are my hands clean? Is my heart pure? And that everything, every blockage will be removed. Everything even within me which has to be relinquished to provide the means of you being able to accomplish whatever you still have to accomplish in and through this vessel of thine own will all be done from this moment forth, that you shall come down again, that thy servant here will be in the right place at the right time for the coming down of thyself, the presence of God coming down once more, just like you came down in the parish of Barbas, and that men and women and children will be so convicted of their sins that the cry will be, is there mercy for me? Is there mercy for me? For this is asked, it is done for thy glory, because it's through thy beloved one, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.